The Safavid Empire of Persia, which existed from 1501 to 1736, was a Shiite Muslim dynasty that controlled the region from the eastern border of the Ottoman Empire through Iran and into what's now Afghanistan and Georgia and Armenia and even Pakistan. The Safavids' greatest ruler, Shah Abbas the Great, moved his capital to Isfahan in central Iran. The ancient Persian city had once been a home for Israelite refugees freed from the Babylonian captivity of the Old Testament by the first great ruler of the Persian Empire, Cyrus the Great, in the 6th century BCE. Shah Abbas continued this tradition by allowing refugees to settle in Isfahan. He welcomed hundreds of thousands of Armenians in the early 1600s. From the disputed border region that separated Shiite Safavid Persia from the Sunni Ottoman Empire. After the Armenian genocide in 1915 during World War I, the Armenian quarter of Isfahan actually became one of the oldest and largest Armenian centers in the world. The Mughal Empire of India was established in 1526, also by a Persian-speaking dynasty that traced its authority back to Genghis Khan's second son, Chagatai. The empire formed in a region that had been conquered by Tamerlane, who consolidated the remains of several khanates. Tamerlane had wanted to reassemble Genghis Khan's Mongol Empire. He also considered himself the Sword of Islam. Tamerlane died in 1405 on the way to a planned invasion of Ming China, which his successor immediately called off. 1405, if you recall, was the year that the Yongle Emperor sent Zheng He out on his first voyage. So the Ming were pretty formidable at that moment. Inspired by Tamerlane's fusion of cultures and religious movements, a new religion called Sikhism developed in the Punjab in the 15th century by combining elements of the traditional Hinduism of the region with Islam. Sikhs opposed India's caste system, and they were much less pacifistic than the Hindus, ultimately becoming the legendary warriors of the subcontinent and contributing very much to the British Empire's efforts in the First and the Second World Wars. The Mughals, from whom we get the term Mughal, ruled a wealthy empire that included most of the Indian subcontinent and large parts of Afghanistan. It lasted until 1857, and at its peak, it ruled a population of over 150 million people. The Mughal Golden Age began in 1556 with the reign of Akbar the Great, who expanded the empire's territory but continued to allow his Indian subjects to keep their languages and their religions. Hinduism, which is still the dominant religion of India, is an amalgamation of ancient traditions and practices originating centuries before the development of Judaism and the other monotheistic religions of the Middle East. It's a polytheistic religion with many gods and goddesses, and a central element of it are the stories of the relations among these gods and goddesses and their relationships with humanity. And these stories are designed to provide guidance and to help explain the human condition. Notably, because their religion stems from so many different practices from different regions and different time periods, differences related to religious practice have rarely divided Hindus. As we'll see later in Indian history, the big religious difference of opinion was between Muslims and Hindus. Akbar's grandson, Shah Jahan, who reigned from 1628 to 1658, was also a very accomplished military leader. But his reign is remembered mostly for its opulence and its architectural achievements. Among them is the Taj Mahal, which was a mosque and tomb that Shah Jahan built for his favorite wife, Mumtaz Mahal. To the north of both the Ottoman and the Safavid empires, the Russian Empire grew out of resistance to Mongol rule after the fall of Constantinople. A ruler of the Grand Duchy of Moscow named Ivan III, later called Ivan the Great, refused to pay the tribute demanded by the Golden Horde. And after the death of the last Greek Orthodox Christian emperor, Ivan decided that his kingdom should become the new Rome. Ivan, who reigned from 1462 to 1505, tripled the size of his state and rebuilt the Kremlin in Moscow. His grandson, Ivan IV, is called Ivan the Terrible most of the time, although the Russian word Grozny actually means something more like awesome. Ivan IV reigned from 1547 to 1584, and he was the first person to declare himself Tsar of all the Russias. The title Tsar is the Russian word for Caesar. He annexed the Khanates of Kazan and Astrakhan and Siberia, and recruited Cossacks from southern Russia and Ukraine to colonize and rule over Siberia. Once Russia encompassed Siberia, it became the largest kingdom in the world, stretching from the Black Sea all the way to the Pacific Ocean. Although much of this Siberian territory was unoccupied or very sparsely peopled by Siberian tribes. Peter I, known as Peter the Great, reigned from 1672 to 1725 and visited Europe in disguise for 18 months to study shipbuilding and the new administrative techniques that were becoming popular in Europe. And he brought back the technology and the administration and used it to modernize his realm and to establish the Russian Empire. We'll return, of course, to Russia later in the semester. But let's explore now some of the things that attracted Peter to Europe in the late 1600s. Before we do that, though, a couple more questions for you. Why were the Ottomans and the Safavids always at war? Secondly, what was the advantage for empires like the Mughal of letting the subject peoples retain their languages and religions and customs? And then finally, what do you think it was that attracted Peter the Great to study Europe?